70% of security and IT leaders view the public cloud as the riskiest part of their technology stack. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice at the Cube Research. I'm joined today by Haim. Haim, how are you doing?
I'm doing well, thanks. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, great to have you on. Why don't you tell the audience a little bit about yourself and about Gigamon?
Yeah, absolutely. My name is Haim Mazal, and I'm the Chief AI and Security Officer here at Gigamon. My responsibilities are information security, IT, network, infrastructure, as well as product security and AI strategy. So a little bit about Gigamon. So Gigamon empowers organizations to see and manage all their network traffic, providing deep visibility and intelligent insights in the secure optimal digital infrastructure. So that means delivering actionable network intelligence. And Gigamon helps businesses detect threats faster, improve performance, and simplify security operations. And really what that means is we use immutable network telemetry to unify visibility across any asset in any environment.
Super excited to have you here, Haim. I mean, it really is an exciting time in the industry. I mean, when we're looking at AI, how it's changing the way enterprises are thinking about security, it's really starting to show that's really a big focal point, right? I started out with 70% of IT security leaders, you know, looking at the public cloud as the riskiest part of their stack. But with AI workloads scaling fast, network traffic really exploding, traditional tools just really not keeping up. So it's great to have you on to talk about this. Many teams are finding that it's hard to spot that rogue behaviors or autonomous threats before they cause real damage. And it's important to understand this because why, you know, like deep observability is moving from a nice to have to it is a must have, right? So those organizations are really starting to mature, but going beyond logs and tapping into real network intelligence, organizations really get to understand the visibility they need to stay ahead of the AI kind of driven risks that really come up, right? So when we start looking at this at this point, cloud strategy isn't just about cost or scale anymore. It's really about security and how it evolves as AI does. So Haim, let's talk about a couple of things here. What are your thoughts on, you know, traditional tools and why they're failing and how they fail to detect rogue AI behaviors such as network traffic surges?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think traditional tooling, you know, was very purpose-built, depending on if you were on on-premise infrastructure, maybe if you were in cloud infrastructure, or virtualization, you know, internally in private cloud. So, you know, having this disparate tool set across all of your environments and, you know, ingesting different logs, you know, different forms of melt and things like that, there was not really a strong, you know, congruity between how those things were pieced together. So I think one of the big challenges is looking at all these specific tools that provide all these values for your teams, whether it's network operations, security operations, or cloud operations, and giving them a steel thread to be able to unify those data sets, to be able to speak a singular language, and to really be able to have a clear single pane of glass to be able to have informed conversations that allow you to improve your performance, improve your security controlling, and being able to identify potential traffic, like particular AI traffic, right? We've seen huge surges, you know, almost 200% increase in traffic across organizations in the last year and a half, 2 years. And there's not a lot of real-time solutions to be able to, you know, help your organization. So whether that was using, you know, commercial AI tooling that was cloud-based and hosted, you know, if you have a great, you know, gateway and you have ingress, egress, maybe you'd be able to identify some of the traffic. A lot of these data sets are not formalized data sets, so it's hard to go ahead and find repeatable patterns. So a lot of companies have been left flying blind. And then also with companies wanting to roll out their own LLMs internally and be able to roll out their own models and be able to serve their organization with its product team, or whether that's from a corporate perspective, it's almost impossible to identify that traffic across environments, whether that's, you know, lateral traffic or whether that's traffic that's taking place, again, from an ingress-egress perspective into alternative environments, right? So I think a big portion of this is the saying like, hey, how do we enable organizations? How do we allow them to be able to do what they need to do as far as innovation, but being able to draw, you know, a singular theme across where we can see that uptick in traffic, we can identify it, we can go ahead and potentially segment it, we can implement zero trust policies, we can apply the appropriate controls to allow organizations to be successful internally.
Yeah, there's a lot there to talk about, right? You touched on a lot of different points, and it's very, really important to kind of for the audience to really understand this. You know, what I just fielded a number of studies, four studies in my practice across day zero, day one, day two, and DevSecOps, and anything in the CI/CD pipeline. And you know, we're seeing that bridging the gap between heritage environments and new environments is a challenge. We're seeing that when it comes to traditional observability or networking tools, that you know, NPM is definitely up there in the kind of focal points. But there's also, like you said, this more of a holistic view across new ways of delivering applications, new ways of viewing data, and viewing data in ways that traditionally wasn't really the way those tools were meant to be. So the challenges that you kind of touched on, or the solutions that you touched on to those challenges, really kind of drive home the point of we're evolving, we're changing. But that also introduces why 70% of these leaders are now viewing public cloud as a risky part of their stack. Why do you think that is the case now? Because if you look at heritage environments, the public cloud was viewed as pretty secure to some extent, but now we have things like MCP and agents and everything pulling data all over the place. It becomes vulnerable. What are your thoughts?
Absolutely. So I think there's a multitude of reasons. I think, you know, one of the reasons is for a lot of larger organizations that have been very successful for longer periods of time, talent is still really a driving factor. So you might be able to be as part of your, you know, digital transformation, your modernization stack, and you move to public cloud and you think you have a good hold and understanding. But when it really comes to implementing controls uniformly across the board and being able to create that visibility and create insights to be able to send to your security operations team, to be able to send to your cloud operations team, I still think there's a big gap in the industry. And no, I know we've been on this journey for a long period of time, but I still think a lot of the skill sets and leveling hasn't exactly caught up. And then I think there's also too a multitude of technical implications that are new, like you said, as far as agentic AI and MCPs and things like that. And so one of the major problems is that we have a huge issue with data access management, identity access management, and provisioning and permissioning. So in order for us to enable our organizations to be successful, a lot of times we have to overly be permissive with what our agentic AI is accessing, what permissions it has, and how those data sets are being transferred for whatever the use case is for the organization. And people still really haven't figured out a good way to address this in a holistic manner. And so the first step is obviously visibility. If you can't have visibility into the traffic and you don't have detailed insight into what actually is happening transactionally across your organization, it's almost impossible to go ahead and implement the appropriate controls with the correct tooling or not. So I think this has been a big struggle for a lot of organizations, and it's still posing a lot of challenges. But you know, at Gigamon, we feel very passionately about, you know, being able to identify the traffic, being able to identify the permissionings, being able to identify those specific data sets, and then being able to feed the right data to the right tools at the right time so your teams can have normalized conversations about how to come up with a uniform way to go ahead and draw the controls across that is the winning recipe.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, and it tracks to the research I'm seeing. I'll touch on the skill gap issues that you mentioned. Skill gaps is absolutely a big challenge. We see that in our research, organizations, 67% of organizations are hiring generalists or specialists, not because they can't find, not because they don't want to hire specialists, they just can't find the specialist. So it's a challenge. So what they're doing is they're pushing back on organizations, organizations push back on vendors to reduce the complexity, right? And allow for a generalist to do the deployments and such. So I think that's a big part of it. The other thing I want to touch on is you mentioned around, you know, access management, right? So there's human access management, there's machine access management, and there's also kind of this new level of non-human access management. This is the agent piece, right? This is when data is being extracted out of systems of record, heritage systems of record. And in the existing system of record, the security protocols are all in place in that system. But once you extract out the information, you're starting to lose some of the integrity of the security that goes along with that data. So to your point, this non-human interaction of allowing for AI to drive forward, to deliver, is really what a lot of organizations are moving towards, right? We see only 36% of security leaders have a seat at the AI strategy table. And this is despite all being accountable for all these breaches. Now, the reason we see this is a lot of these organizations are looking at AI as the way of the future. They don't want to be left behind. They don't want to be in a competitive disadvantage, right? So when we look at the pieces here around, bringing AI to the table, bringing the security, and you mentioned, I really think that talking about those breaches, but yet the risk is still there. Organizations are willing to take the risk, even though they feel like they're not secure in this. What are your thoughts around that?
Yeah, no, you hit the nail on the head. So again, the non-human piece for the agentic AI piece, I think the real driver is the complexity of environments, right? If you had a holistic singular environment, right, it would provide a lot of comfortability that things could potentially be easier. But as we watch organizations scale and as we watch them make investments across a multitude of environments, again, whether it's public cloud, virtualization, and private cloud, or whether that's on-premise, right, we have a intertangled mesh of communication of ingress, egress. And you have to think traditionally, people invested in their core competencies and created silos around that. So your security operations center, organization security operations center, might be on-prem. But you might be feeding that on-prem security operations center through all of your cloud environments and all of your virtualization environments. And so it creates a lot of discrepancy across data sets, and it creates a lot of risk for organizations. So at Black Hat this year, I spoke with a tremendous amount of peers, and everyone is saying the same thing. Everyone is being tasked with how they go ahead and enable their organization to be successful with AI deployments and implementation and innovation. And they're also saying that they're seeing a large increase of those responsibilities from a strategy perspective also falling into their lap as well. So I think one of the major drivers that we're seeing here is that security is going to end up being one of the main drivers and innovators for AI across the board. Because if you think about all the technology pieces and all the strategy that takes places for security leaders across their organizations, this is just another piece of the puzzle. So I think this is going to continue to shift further and further. I think we're going to see that number go from 36. I think we're going to watch it exponentiate quite quickly. And I think, again, in order for companies to be successful, it has to be part and parcel. And we're a strong believer of that in Gigamon. So I'm in charge of AI strategy. I'm in charge of AI security here as a whole as well. But I think also the other piece to that is that when we really look at everything coming together in this perfect confluence and events, right? If security is not the driver, we're going to be way behind the ball, just like we saw with modern public cloud deployments and things of that nature. So, you know, there's also a lot of tremendous things that Gigamon is doing to help enable our customers, whether it's security, network, or cloud professionals, be able to identify a lot of this traffic, whether it's agentic traffic, whether it's Gen AI traffic, or it's rolled out LLMs, just by being able to go ahead and provide visibility into these non-structured data sets, regardless of where the transaction is happening across their environments, and then bring it into a comprehensive picture. And I think if we don't have things like this to support us as security professionals and leaders, it's going to be a very, very continued uphill battle.
Yeah, I mean, without a doubt. I mean, I think sometime during my career, somebody once told me that you have to slow down to go faster, right? With regards to security, right? If you're developing applications, you're pushing it out the door, and you're not worrying about the security elements, you're actually doing yourself a disadvantage, because you're going to potentially have reputation risk, not to say that you'll have vulnerabilities in your product and whatever it may be. So that just gets amplified with AI, right? But I want to talk a little bit about the convergence or the kind of collection here between observability and security. I think that when we start bringing these things together, it's very clear in my mind, according to my day two study, which is operations, it's very clear in my mind that there is a whole grouping of different elements of observability. Organizations are not really, not really mature in their observability practices. So they end up trying to do these silos. In fact, what we see that there's 75% of the respondents indicated that they're using 6 to 15 different tools, and 54% of those respondents indicated that they're in favor of moving to a full stack observability solution. You mentioned earlier, single pane of glass. I know in tech, that's like the kind of taboo words, like don't say single pane of glass because there isn't such a thing, but that's what organizations are looking for, right? And having, we also mentioned skill gap issues, having generalists being able to look at this view, a holistic view across observability platforms. And then, you know, as we're moving forward, security is either number one or number two in the actionable insights. So when something happens that gets bubbled up, whether you're doing APM, NPM, tracing, logging, whatever it may be, if something comes up, security is the number one and number two piece. So when we look at, you know, how deep observability is becoming a must-have for securing these autonomous AI solutions or projects across hybrid multi-cloud ecosystems, it really is that focal point. So what are your thoughts around that data point when we think about, you know, all these tools all over the place, all these kind of silos of things, kind of not really having that unified view, but just lots of individuals trying to do their jobs, trying to get their jobs done, but they just have their own bespoke solutions to do so. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely. I don't think that's going anywhere. I think obviously different teams have different requirements and have different end goals. And so from our perspective, that single pane of glass is not necessarily the tools that are materializing the data, serving the different functions across the organization. But really what that is that that's the singularity in the data set. So deep observability for us is, you know, obviously logging and trace, but it's also augmenting it with immutable network traffic that exists across all your assets, across all your environments, and being able to create basically a singular language that you can feed to all of those data sets and all of those tools that can't be tampered with, that can't be forged, that is your source of truth that will allow organizations and allow all these different operational teams to be able to have sanity checks and have conversations with each other and be able to validate these large data sets, right? There's the age-old adage, it's easy to log, it's hard to log well. So a lot of times these organizations have log fatigue. You know, we just turn on the floodgates and we're blasting and you're sending it to all these different tools. And there's disparity in those data because different tools have different logging from different environments. But the real value of deep observability is being able to plug in this immutable network traffic across all of your environments and have those same representative data sets being fed into whatever tool that that team needs to be successful. But when that team, that operational team, whether that's network security or cloud, when they're able to materialize something and escalate something, they can present that data source and everyone will have a clear, defined understanding of exactly what the implications are and exactly what that means to the company.
Yeah, very, very well said. I love it. I love that you kind of, again, I want to translate what you said to bridging the gap between what you're used to doing to the next generation of what you want to be doing, right? I think that's kind of really where that's going. But Haim, this has been awesome having you on. I really think it's great. Your insights are like spot on. And I love it because it aligns nicely to my research and it's kind of validates what I'm doing. So I think that's cool. But there's a lot here to talk about, right? Of course, this is just the tip of the iceberg for the conversation. What would you advise our audience here to go to like learn more if they want to get started, regardless where they are in their journey, if they're just getting started or if they're very well mature in their journey, where would they go?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that you can go to www.gigamon.com and you can check out a lot of our resources and material. We have a lot of great case studies. 87 of the Fortune 100 are our customers. We serve the federal government as our largest customer. And so we're solving a lot of complex problems for a lot of complex organizations and simply, you know, making the day-to-day much, much easier and digestible for some of the largest organizations in the world. And so we're very excited about all our AI tooling and products that are coming out as well. So please feel free. And also I'm looking forward to speaking with you and meeting you.
Thank you very much. Your insights are awesome. Thank you. I really appreciate you joining me as my guest today on the AppDevANGLE. And a big thank you to all of you who've tuned in. We really appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. But for now, that wraps up this episode. But we'll be back next Wednesday with another conversation diving into the tools, trends, and talents shaping the future of application development. Whether you're deploying at the edge, building it with AI, or modernizing your cloud stack, we've got you covered. So be sure to follow us on social. If you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach me at paulann@silicianangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.